All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to First Church of the Nazarene. People are coming in. So glad to be back with all of you this morning. I hear Pastor did a great job last week. And I'm still, unfortunately, a little bit under the weather, so that just means that you get to sing really loud this morning, okay? All right, well, let's stand as we open up our worship with Our God Saves. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on a Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves, our God saves. There is hope in your name. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on a Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will
that you're here this morning, and we're really glad that Emily is back this morning. Let's begin with prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love for us, and thank you for the privilege that you give us of worshiping you and of coming together to be with our brothers and sisters and enjoy your presence. Father, I know that as we come into this place this morning, we're coming in from life and a lot of stuff. A lot of people are facing a lot of different stuff. But I thank you for this place and the sanctuary that it gives us, the opportunity to come in and let go of some of the stuff and focus on you for a while. But I pray that you will, as we focus on you this morning, I pray pray that you will speak into our hearts your life and your peace. That when we leave this place today, we won't leave so chaotically. That we won't just rush back into the chaos and let it overtake us again. But that we will carry that life and peace with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. Well, a couple of announcements this morning as we get started. First of all, there is no evening service tonight. We will resume those again next week. So no evening service tonight. Next announcement is Raymond Marquez, who is a student at Olivet Nazarene University and one of our own, is planning to go on a missions trip in March to Haiti. And some of you may have received a letter from Raymond requesting some help with that missions trip. And he's coming up on his deadline, and he's still a little over $400 short. So if you would like to give to Raymond, just put that in the offering today, or you can pay through PayPal if you would like, and just mark it Raymond Marquez, and then we will get that to him this week. But would encourage you to pray about that if that would be possible to help Raymond to make it on his mission trip to Haiti. Also in the foyer this morning, there are cards for our prayer ornaments. Now those of you who attended church sometime between the end of November and mid-January, we had ornaments on our Christmas tree this year that were with our names on it. If you, and many of you, took those ornaments and are now praying for that person throughout the year, if you would like to let that person know that you have their ornament and that you're praying for them, if there's any specific requests, etc., how they can contact you, there are cards on the corner of the welcome desk. Just grab one of those cards and you can stick it in their mail slot out in the foyer if you like, or you can hand it to them. Just a way to stay in touch and let people know that we're praying for one another as we go through this year. All right, that's all the announcements I have for this morning. So let's stand together again as we continue to worship.
The blood that Jesus shed for me, way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It reaches to the never lose. Jesus, I've forgotten the words that you have spoken. Promises that burn within my heart have now grown dim. With a doubting heart I follow the path of earthly wisdom. Forgive me for my unbelief. Renew the fire again.
As we come together this morning, I know that we come in carrying our burdens and carrying the realities of life. And so we come to this part of the service where we're able to bring our requests and our concerns before our God and know that He hears us. And so we're going to sing through the chorus of this song again. And if you would like to come forward, our altars are open. If you would like special prayer, Pastor Larry and Meyer will be in the corner. But just encourage you to focus on Him this morning. Whatever is going on in life, whatever burdens you're carrying or whatever burdens your friends and family are carrying, encourage you to take advantage of this opportunity to reach out to Him. So you may be seated if you want. You can remain standing. Whatever helps you focus on Him as we sing through this chorus again.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love for us and the privilege that we have of coming into this place today and bringing the messes, the chaos, all of the pain that we deal with in life, bringing that before you and allowing you, the creator of all the universe, to speak into our hearts and our lives. Father, I know that this morning as we gather together, there are a lot of people struggling in a lot of ways. For many this morning, the physical realities are setting in, and the flu and cold season has been brutal the last couple of weeks. For many, it's more than just the flu or the cold. It's the realities of cancer or other challenging health diagnoses. For some in our midst today, there's the realities of grieving and passing anniversaries of important days in their now deceased loved ones' lives that reminds and refreshes those wounds, those pains. For some this morning in this room, there's reminders of relationships. They're not where they want them to be. Choices being made by those that they love that are painful. And we lift these to you today as well. And Father, there's also in this room today some who are struggling financially, trying to figure out where the money's going to come from. How are the bills going to be paid? I just pray for your touch in their lives as well, and your provision in such a way that reminds them that you are God and you are faithful. Father, whatever the need may be today, I am so thankful for your love for us and for the amazing ways that you provide, the amazing things that you do to show us just how much you love us and care for us. And Father, this week, the warm spring-like weather, even though we know that winter will come back, this warm spring-like weather has just reminded us of what an awesome God you are. Reminded us of the warmth of your love as we've experienced the warmth of the sunshine. We thank you that the creator of all the universe cares for us and knows each one of us by name. So as we continue in our time of worship today, I pray that you will speak to us the message that you want us to hear. That we will be able to sense, each one of us, your words speaking into our hearts. That we will know that the creator of the universe is speaking to us today. And Father, in times when we're not exactly sure what to say, when we're perhaps overwhelmed or just at a loss, we find great comfort and great joy in praying together the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. The pain of searing love. bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. What should I gain from but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. What should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
All right, if our ushers will come forward at this time, we'll continue to worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings. I can pray for our offerings this morning.
Lord, thank you for being with us in your Holy Spirit and for our fellowship together. Thank you for all that you do for everyone in this world every day in every way. Please bless our offering today. For all power, honor, praise, and glory is yours forever. Amen.
Our worship team this morning. Well, we have been reading through the book of Genesis, and today we come to its conclusion. And as we have looked at the book of Genesis, there are a number of storylines that play into this book. And if you think back to when we started the book of Genesis back in January, and we talked about the story of creation that is told in the book of Genesis. And then from the story of creation, it goes very quickly into how after humanity was created, things went really bad. And humans were very sinful and very evil. And then we reach chapter 12 of Genesis. And the story takes a very different twist. And instead of just telling the story of humanity in general, we start to see the story of one man's family. It starts out in chapter 12 with a man named Abraham. Abram was his name at that time. He hadn't earned the ham yet. Some of you got that. Starts out with a story of a man named Abraham, or Abram, and how God called him from where he was at and said, "Come and follow me to a land that I will show you." And as he left and started to go where God would show him, a whole bunch of life happened, and his story unfolds. The reality that God had promised him that he would make him the father of many nations, but he didn't have any children. And how when he was 99 years old, his wife conceived. And she was 90 or 89 at the time. Yeah, I hear that. Have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And they gave birth to a son named Isaac. And Isaac eventually gave birth to twin sons named Jacob and Esau. Esau was the older, but it was Jacob who received the blessing because he was a little sneak. And Jacob, who was crafty and manipulative his entire life, had at least 12 sons. And they were crafty and manipulative as their father was. And so this story kind of unfolds, and we see the life that develops. And quite honestly, for much of what we've been reading for the last few weeks, we just get this sense of, this just seems to be going further and further and further downhill. It's telling us the story of God as how and how he related to humanity, but these humans just keep going further and further and further away from him. But this week, we got to read finally some good news, a story of redemption. Jacob's 12 sons, one of which was Joseph. Joseph was the son of his favorite wife, and you remember that we have not in any way condoned or accepted the fact that Jacob had many wives. That's a very poor choice on his part, because there's all those mother-in-laws that come with every wife. But it was cultural at that time, and we're not going to spend time unpacking that. Because Joseph was the oldest son of Jacob's favorite wife, Joseph then became the favorite son. And it wasn't just that he was a favorite in a kind of secretive way. He was very blatant that Joseph was the favorite son. And everybody knew that Joseph was the favorite. And Joseph's brothers hated him because he was the favorite. They hated him so much that eventually things would go very badly for Joseph. But a part of the reason that things went badly for Joseph is because Joseph followed in his father's footsteps as a very unlikable guy. If you've been reading with us, you remember that Jacob had made a mess out of every relationship that he had. Jacob had made a mess out of relationships with his brother Esau and had to flee for his life because his brother wanted to kill him. So he went to his mother's homeland and spent time with his mother's family and ended up marrying two wives at that place. and continued to make a mess out of relationships by butchering the relationship that he had with his father-in-law to the point where, once again, he had to flee. But he's caught between fleeing from his father-in-law, who now hates him, and fleeing back to the land of his brother, who still hates him, most likely. He doesn't know for sure. He just knows that when he left, his brother was ready to kill him. Jacob was not the nicest guy. Joseph followed in his father's footsteps of making messes out of relationships. Not only was it clear that he was his father's favorite, but he was also a dreamer. Now, there's nothing wrong with being a dreamer. There's nothing wrong with having ideas and having visions and having dreams and saying, this is what I see happening. Unless what you see happening is your entire family bowing down before you and telling them about it when they already hate you. And that's what Joseph did. He had a dream where they were in the field and they were putting together grain, and all of their grain bowed down before his grain. Now, it's one thing to have the dream. It's another thing to share that dream with his brothers, but he did. And because he was so loved by his father, it just complicated that dream a little bit more. His brothers finally come up with a plan to kill him. He's coming to check on them because he's not the one actually out there doing the work with his brothers. You'll notice that. He's actually home with Daddy. And Daddy says, you know, we haven't heard from the boys lately. Somebody better go check on them. Joseph, why don't you go check on them? So Joseph goes and checks on his brothers. And they see him coming. They recognize him because Daddy gave him this very, very noticeable fancy coat that none of them had. And they see that coat coming, and they say, we're going to get him. We're going to kill him. All we have to do is agree on a story that we tell Dad. And nobody else is out here. Nobody else will ever know what has happened. The oldest brother, who's already gotten in trouble for inappropriate behavior, such as sleeping with one of his father's wives, comes up with this idea that I don't want to kill him because I've already made Dad mad enough. And so he convinces them to put him in a well or a cistern, and then we'll figure out what to do with him. Now, Reuben's plan, it appears later, was to go back and release Joseph, but tell him not to tell anybody that he did anything nice for him, but don't tell Dad that they did anything bad to him. While Reuben is off doing something else, the brothers come up with another idea. Rather than just killing him, why don't we make some money off of this? Let's sell him as a slave to a group of slave traders who are traveling by. And so they sell Joseph into slavery. He ends up in Egypt, which is where that particular caravan was heading, and is purchased by a man named Potiphar. And Potiphar, who was in charge of Pharaoh's guard and was very high-ranking in the Egyptian culture, Potiphar has Joseph serving him in a role that eventually he becomes the top servant in this household. And his top servant, for some reason, Potiphar's wife decides that she would like to know Joseph better. And Joseph rejects her advances. And in her frustration over his rejection, she ends up falsely accusing Joseph. And so Joseph ends up in prison. While in prison, he once again rises to the top. He's given authority over other prisoners and ends up with authority over two of Pharaoh's servants. And they have troubling dreams that they share with him, and he interprets their dreams. The first is Pharaoh's cupbearer. The cupbearer has a dream, and Joseph interprets this dream for him, which basically says, Pharaoh has been very angry with you, but Pharaoh is over it. And in 3 days, you're going to be restored to your post, and you will once again serve Pharaoh. The other dream was had by Pharaoh's baker. And I'm sure that the cupbearer's dream was so positive that the baker was happy to share his dream, and Joseph interpreted it and not so positively said, Pharaoh is not finished with his anger towards you, and in 3 days you will not be released. In 3 days you will be impaled, and the birds of the sky will come down and eat your flesh. That's the dream. Both of those dreams come true. And Joseph's parting words to the cupbearer was, please remember me because I have been unjustly imprisoned. So when you get back to Pharaoh, remember that I told you this was going to happen, and I'm not supposed to be here. And the cupbearer promptly forgets anything about Joseph. Until a couple of years later, when Pharaoh has a dream that no one else can interpret. And so the cupbearer is reminded of Joseph and checks and finds out he's still in prison. So he tells Pharaoh about Joseph. And so Joseph is called forth to interpret this dream for Pharaoh, which he does. And he does so in such a way, he predicts that there's going to be 7 years of bounty, of abundant harvests, and then followed by 7 years of famine. And he tells Pharaoh, you really need to find the wisest person you can find and put him in charge of all of collecting during this time of abundance so that when the famine comes, then you're not going to be caught unaware and you will survive. And of course, none of the other wise guys in the kingdom of Egypt could interpret Pharaoh's dream, so who is wiser than Joseph? And so Joseph is placed second in command. And he stockpiles the crops for the 7 years of abundance. He purchases the crops from the people, and they're happy to sell their crops to Pharaoh. And so Joseph stockpiles all of these crops. And then when the famine comes, he sells the stockpiles and makes a nice little profit. In fact, if you read through with us this week, you kind of got the sense that Joseph was pretty crooked in the way that he dealt with these. Because the first year, people would come and they would pay the money that they had been paid for selling their crops. The second year, they would come and they said, we don't have any money left. We just have ourselves and our livestock. And he said, well, I'll take your livestock. And the third year, they said, all we have is ourselves and our land. And he said, well, I'll take the land. In the fourth year, they come and they say, all we have is ourselves. And he's like, great, you'll make great slaves. It's not exactly the way that I would have pictured that from an honest and ethical perspective. But that's what Joseph does. And because of that, he's highly respected by Pharaoh. Nobody else likes him, but he's highly respected by Pharaoh. But it's not just the Egyptians that come and buy food from the Egyptians. It's all of the people from the surrounding areas, including his family, who comes in from Canaan. Because the famine has reached there as well, and they hear that Egypt has food. His brothers come to Joseph. They don't know that it's him. They don't recognize him. He's dressed a whole lot better than he was when they sold him into slavery. He doesn't speak the language that they speak. He doesn't speak the Hebrew in front of them. He speaks in Egyptian. And they don't know that it's him, but he certainly recognizes them. And he plays with them a bit. He has a little bit of fun with his brothers. They come the first time and they try to buy the grain. And his response is, you're a bunch of spies. Of course, he doesn't say that to them. He speaks through an interpreter so they don't know that he's understanding. You guys are just a bunch of spies. How do I know that you're telling the truth? And they speak back to him through the interpreter, and oh, we are not spies. We are 11 honest men, and our father is still in the land of Canaan, and there's one more brother, but he's not here with us, but we're all honest men. We're just hungry, and we're trying to buy grain. And that's the true story. I wouldn't say too much about the honest part, but Joseph agrees to sell grain, but he puts a little test out there. He says, "So that I know that you are honest, I'm going to keep one of your brothers here in prison. And if you have one more brother, the next time you come back to buy grain, you better bring him with you. Because I want to know that you're honest. And if he doesn't come back, then the one who's in prison will eventually die. But you have to bring him back with you." And he spoke to them so angrily that they were really scared. So they leave one of their brothers in prison, and they go back to their father, and they eat the grain that they've purchased. When they are on their way back, they realize that Joseph had instructed his servants to put their money that they had paid for the grain on top of their bags so it would look like they stole the grain. That scared them a little bit. They got back to their father, they explained what had happened, and the father just said, "You're not taking the youngest son. You're not taking Benjamin. It's Joseph's younger brother. It's the only son that he has left from his favorite wife. And he's still grieving and still upset about Joseph, and he's not happy about this, and he's saying, you can't take Benjamin. But then, as often happens, they started to get hungry. And they said, "Dad, we've got to go back to Egypt, but we have to take Benjamin with us. This guy, you don't understand, he was a real jerk. And he said if we don't bring Benjamin back, he won't sell us anymore. And if we go back and we don't take Benjamin, he's going to think we're all spies and he's going to kill us all." And the father says, "I will not lose Benjamin." Which says to these brothers, "I don't care about your heads. I just care about Benjamin's." And then he follows that up by saying, "Because if I lost Benjamin, I don't know what I would do with myself." Now, what message does that send to 10 brothers as far as their value? Doesn't make them think too kindly of Benjamin either, does it? So they come back, they finally convince their father that they have to take Benjamin back. They take Benjamin back, and they come to before Joseph. The brother who was imprisoned is released. But Joseph once again decides to play with them. So this time, instead of just putting their money on top, and they explain when they get back to Joseph, "The last time we were here, somehow our money ended up on top. So here's the money from last time, and here's the money from this time. We want to honestly buy this grain. We're not spies. We want you to know that we are who we say we are." And Joseph again instructs that their money be put back on top of their grain bags, but to take his own personal silver cup and put it in Benjamin's sack. And so they take their grain. They don't know that Benjamin's sack has this cup in it. They head back home, all 11 brothers. They're excited. They made it through this. And Joseph sends soldiers after them and says, "How dare you insult our master? You come here saying that you were honest men. He agreed to sell you grain that he didn't have to sell you. And one of you stole his personal cup. How dare you?" And of course, the brothers were very nervous at this point and just said, "We didn't do it. We promise if you find it in anybody's bags, let that man be killed." And so they searched the bags. And Benjamin's bags were the last ones to be searched. And lo and behold, there in Benjamin's bag is Joseph's cup. So the brothers at this point are absolutely beside themselves. They all go back before Joseph, and Joseph says, "I don't want to see 10 of you. I only want Benjamin, and I'm going to kill him for stealing from me. The rest of you can go. You're free to go." And then Joseph watches what happens as they melt before him. And all of the brothers now start begging him to kill them instead. To not take this younger brother, that they would give their lives in place of Benjamin's. And Joseph has still not spoken to them in Hebrew and doesn't know that he can understand everything that they're saying. And then he hears a statement that they say to each other that they don't know that he can hear, where they say, "Surely this is happening to us because of what we did to our brother Joseph. Surely this is happening to us because of what we did to Joseph." If you can imagine for Joseph in this moment, the emotion that he felt. In fact, several times during his interactions with his brothers, he cast them out and then brought them back in because he had to deal with his emotions. He had within his power to say the word, and the 10 brothers who had thrown him into a well and sold him as a slave could have been instantly dead. And he had it in his power to do it in the most painful way possible because the Egyptians were good at torture, just as the Romans would later be. He could have caused them to be tortured. All of the vengeance that had stirred in his mind, as he said in prison, as he said in slavery, he could have done them in. But I want us to read how he responded instead. If you have your Bibles and you want to follow along with us, we're going to be in Genesis chapter 45. Or if you have the church app, if you want to open it up and click the little button at the bottom, it will pop up with this passage. Finally, Joseph could stand it no longer. There were many people in the room, and he said to his attendants, "Out, all of you." So he was alone with his brothers when he told them who he was. Then he broke down and wept. He wept so loudly that the Egyptians could hear him. The word of it quickly carried to Pharaoh's palace. "I am Joseph," he said to his brothers. "Is my father still alive?" But his brothers were speechless. They were stunned to realize that Joseph was standing there in front of them. "Please come closer," he said to them. So they came closer. And he said again, "I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into slavery in Egypt. But don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves for selling me to this place. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. This famine that has ravaged the land for 2 years will last 5 more years, and there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. But God has sent me ahead of you to keep you and your families alive and to preserve many survivors. So it was God who sent me here, not you. And he is the one who made me an advisor to Pharaoh, the manager of his entire palace, and the governor of all Egypt. Now hurry back to my father and tell him, 'This is what your son Joseph says. God has made me master over all of the land of Egypt, so come down to me immediately. You can live in the region of Goshen, where you can be near me with all of your children and grandchildren, your flocks and herds, and everything you own. And I will take care of you, for there are still 5 years of famine ahead of us. Otherwise, you and your household and all of your animals will starve.' Then Joseph added, 'Look, you can see me for yourselves, and so can my brother Benjamin, that I really am Joseph. Go tell my father of my honored position here in Egypt. Describe for him everything you have seen, and then bring my father here quickly.' And weeping with joy, he embraced Benjamin, and Benjamin did the same. Then Joseph kissed each of his brothers and wept over them. And after that, they began talking freely with him." You know, the moment that Joseph revealed to his brothers who he was, the world changed. His brothers, who thought they were just there to buy grain, Their world changed the moment that Joseph revealed his identity. Because now they have a whole new set of problems, don't they? This brother who they hated so bitterly, who dreamed of them bowing down before him, his dreams had come true. And here they were on their knees. And Joseph chose not to be spiteful. He had every reason to. He had a right to their heads based on their treachery. He had a right to kill them based on how they had treated him. And instead, he chose to use his position to provide for those who had caused him so much harm. The rest of the story tells us that Jacob and all of his descendants, all of his sons and daughters and grandchildren, and all of their livestock came to Egypt. They're all saved from the famine, and they're given the best land in Egypt to care for their flocks. While there was a great famine going on and crops weren't growing, the area that they were given in the land of Goshen is a land that is irrigated by the Nile, full of canals. And if even today, if you were to go to Google Earth and look at a picture of Egypt from Google Earth, you'll see this beautiful green stretch, and then it's all desert from there. They were given that green stretch because the Nile, the canals, the streams would go through there. And even though it wasn't raining, there was still plenty of water in the Nile, and they were able to find plenty of grain or plenty of grass for their flocks. Jacob will come to Egypt and will see his son Joseph in his position of power, and then will die in peace. And is taken back to Canaan to be buried in a royal Egyptian procession. And Joseph continues to care for his brothers even with dad gone. And you can imagine their fear that perhaps Joseph was just being nice to them because dad was still alive, but once dad was gone, now is Joseph going to lower the boom? And Joseph assures them as they're coming back to Egypt in the funeral processional, "You don't have to worry. I'm not going to kill you. You're my brothers." And the Israelites will flourish in the land of Egypt. But the story doesn't end there. And in fact, starting tomorrow, we're going to read what happens next as we start the book of Exodus. About 400 years will pass between what we read today and what we read tomorrow. The Egyptians will change leadership, and along will come a Pharaoh who doesn't know Joseph and how he saved them, and he starts to become very intimidated by the Israelites and starts to oppress them, and to where eventually they are his slaves. We'll talk about that next week. But this week I want us to recognize the story of redemption. It's redemption for Joseph, because Joseph is the one who, although he deserved part of it, still did not deserve to be sold into slavery. And when he was sold into slavery, he certainly did not deserve to be imprisoned for being falsely accused by Potiphar's wife. And what we've read and what we've talked about this week is it's a story of redemption, because all of the things that he had been falsely accused of, now it was all out into the light, and it was all okay. It was also a story of redemption for Joseph's father, Jacob. Again, Jacob is one who deserves 90% of what happens to him. But at the same time, he was a father who loved his son. And the redemption story didn't punish him for loving his son too much. the story of redemption said, come and see your son is still alive. But I think the part that we can relate to the most is this is a story of redemption for Joseph's brothers. It's redemption for his brothers who were the cause of him being in Egypt in slavery. And even though they had no clue what happened to him after they sold him, I'm sure that he thought of them every day when he was in prison. And in the moment where he had the power to destroy them, he decided instead to redeem them. Stories of redemption always have a crisis. Whenever we hear a story or we talk about a story of redemption, they always have a crisis. There's always a conflict. There's always something that pushes us over the edge. Stories of redemption are always messy. Now, I've had about an hour and 15 minutes between the 2 or 3 weeks that we've talked about Joseph to kind of cover the highlights. I've left out most of the mess. I've touched on the highlights, but there's an awful lot in what we've read that was just really messy in his story. And stories of redemption are always messy. And stories of redemption are always in need of a Savior. Somebody has to come along and do something that redeems this situation, that takes the mess and sets things to right again. The stories of redemption aren't always neatly resolved. You know, the truth is that Joseph still had the baggage. He still had the stuff to deal with. And you know, his brothers never did fully trust him. And there was always those missing years where Joseph didn't have the opportunity to be with his family. Redemption doesn't always mean that everything's perfect. At least not in this life. But redemption is a major theme in the Bible. In fact, you could say that it is the theme of the Bible. It's a story of redemption. A story of those who are created for a purpose, who abandon that purpose and become what they are not supposed to be. And yet there is a God who chases after them to give them hope when they are hopeless, to come to them in the midst of their messes. He doesn't tell his children to clean themselves up before they come to him. He says, come to me. And this is the theme of the Bible. And we like stories of redemption. I mean, this is a great movie, isn't it? I did someone loan me the Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat, and they kind of skewed a few of the details, in case you're wondering. But we like stories of redemption. We like it when good wins out in the end. We like these stories because the truth is we are all in need of redemption. We all come to this place where we recognize that we're in messes that we've created that we don't know how we created. And nobody around us may see the messes. You know, the truth is that had Joseph been killed by wild animals like his brothers told his father, they're standing before Joseph in Egypt or before whoever that prime minister would have been. There was nothing wrong if the story had been as they had told the story. But their guilty consciences brought them to the reality that this is because life was messy and they had sinned. They had made choices that they should not have made. But we all have. we have all made choices that we should not have made. And we're not here to tell all of our stories. But we are all in need of redemption. But the important thing to understand is that redemption is not our story. It's God's story. This is who God is. God is not a God who says, Emmanuel, go clean that up. He's a God who says, Emmanuel, I will walk with you as we clean this up. And God worked out the details in this story, both from the beginning to the end, in ways that Joseph never could have worked out. And God assured Joseph that he was working even when it didn't make sense. Joseph had no clue that God was working when he was sitting in prison for doing the right thing. But God was working. Redemption isn't just the Old Testament story that we read about in Genesis. It's the theme of the New Testament as well. Redemption is the story of Jesus who went to the cross to redeem us. When it didn't make sense to anyone, including Jesus' disciples, who told him, you can't do this. This doesn't make sense. Joseph's brothers did not deserve to be redeemed. But Joseph extended grace. And the truth is that we don't deserve to be redeemed either. But Jesus extends to us grace. So as the worship team comes and as we prepare to close this morning, let's switch it up and sing Lord Have Mercy again if we could. I just want to ask you this question. Have you received and accepted this redemption that Jesus came to offer? Because it so often in our culture, we tend to think that before I can accept this, I have to clean myself up. I have to be good enough. I have to do things my way. You know, Joseph could have spoken through the interpreter when he heard them saying, this is because of Joseph, and said, you guys need to figure out what happened to that brother that you sold and fix this, and then walked away and left them to try to piece together the puzzle. You know, the truth is they never could have pieced together that puzzle because they had no clue what happened to their brother after they sold him. They probably did not keep the receipt when they sold him. And they probably couldn't track down the guys that they sold him to. And it had been long enough that they probably couldn't track down the records of who bought him when he got to Egypt, assuming that he got to Egypt. Joseph didn't say, figure this out, boys. Joseph offered that redemption and said, let me clean this up for you. And God offers us that same redemption. Let me clean up this mess that you're in. And for those of us who may have accepted this redemption, the question for us this morning is, are we walking in freedom? Because I think sometimes it's very easy for us, even though we may have been saved, we may have accepted the grace that Jesus has offered to us. It's very easy for us to walk in such a way that nobody knows. Because we're still carrying the burden, the guilt of what we've done, instead of releasing what we've done. So we're going to sing through the song, Lord, Have Mercy. And if you would like to come and pray, if there's a burden that you're carrying, then our altars are open as we sing. If you want to stand, if you want to remain seated, but I would just encourage you to ponder these two questions. Have you accepted this redemption? And are you walking?
Jesus, I've forgotten the words that you have spoken, promises that burn within my grown dim. With a doubting heart I follow the path of earthly wisdom. Forgive me for my unbelief. Renew the fire again.
Father, we thank you so much for the mercy that you extend to us, the grace that you give us when we are so undeserving. We thank you, and we pray that you will help us to walk in the freedom of that grace today. And as we leave this place, wherever we find ourselves in the story of redemption, whether we have received the redemption, whether we have are still wrestling with that redemption, whether we are trying to make things right, wherever we find ourselves in the story of redemption, would you draw us closer to you and to receiving what you have offered us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And you are dismissed.